The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, second chapter, text number 28 through 38, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded on December 11th, 1968, in Los Angeles.
Manifest in that beginning, manifest in every current state, and unmanifest again when they are annihilated. So what need is that for lamentation? 29.
This is another theory that voidism, that before our this manifested life, there was void. And after this manifestation is over, still there will be void. Because according to voidism, everything is manifested originally void. So Krishna puts forward this argument that before this manifested form of life, there was void. And after this manifested life, there will be void, according to the void philosophy. Then where is the cause of lamentation? There is no cause of lamentation. It was void and it is going to be void. So where is the cause of lamentation? But actually, that is, originally it was not void. That is Bhagavad Gita and Vaishnava theory. Just like Krishna said, that there was no such time when we did not exist. That means, there was no void, there was life. And in future also there will be life. But accepting the theory of voidism, this manifested body is combination of matter. Originally, void means the matter, elementary matter, were not combined. Just like here is an open land. Now, if you combine some bricks and stones and wood, it will appear a big skyscraper building. And if you dismantle, then again it becomes a vacant land. Similarly, in the beginning it was vacant land, and after finishing this body it will be vacant land. So where is the cause of lamentation? For argument's sake, Krishna is putting this reason. Yes, go on.
Some look on the soul as amazing, some describe him as amazing, and some hear of him as amazing, while others, even after hearing about him, cannot understand him at all.
Here, about the soul, the general people, it is amazing. Still, in the modern society, which is so proud of scientific advancement, so far soul is concerned, it is amazement. Nobody understands, still. And those who are hearing about the existence of soul, some of us also in amazement. This is a mysterious thing. And even after hearing, just like some student, there are many students, they are reading Bhagavad Gita, which confirms from the very beginning the existence of soul. But still Bhagavad Gita they are reading daily, they cannot understand what is so. Amazement. So, about the soul and about God, the Supreme Soul, this is the problem of the material world. Srimad Bhagavat says, Naishangamati Savaduru Kramangrin, Prishatta Anatha Pagamoja Dasya, Niskinchananang, Niskinchara. Nobody said. Mahi asanga paduru jubi sikam niskin chananang navanita java. This is a very important verse. It says, the Urukramangri. Urukramangri is the name of the Supreme Personality of God. Uru means big. And Krama means activity. One whose activities are very great. Whose activities are very great. Just try to understand. Now see, the big planet, biggest planet in the universe, the sun glow is floating in the corner of the sky. So whose activity is this? Who has caused this floating? This is called Urukrama, big activity. Not that because you have somehow or other barren some millions of dollars in the bank and you have become Rockefeller or Ford. That does not mean you are a very big worker. Here is the big worker. Millions of planets are floating in the air by his arrangement. He is called Urukramang, big work. So, Bhagavad says, Naishangamati stavat Urukramangri. If anyone understands Urukramangri or the Supreme Lord, for him, to understand the existence of soul is not very difficult. Just like one who has seen the sun glow, for him to understand what is sun sign is not very difficult. But one who is perpetually in the darkness, neither has seen the sun sign nor has seen the sun glow, for him what is light, what is sun, it is very difficult to understand. So, Urukramangri, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, cannot be understood. And if it is understood, Prishatya Anartha Abhagamo Jadartya, if one understands what is Urukramangri, God the Great, then immediately all his ignorance, illusion is over. Anartha upasama. Anartha means just like we are unnecessarily entangled in this material affair. So if one understands the Urukramangri, God, then immediately his entanglement in this unnecessary activities of the material world become stopped. But how it is possible? Mahi asanga padura jubi sikam niskinchananang navanita java. Mahi asanga niskinchananang. Niskinchan means a great personality who has become completely freed from all material consciousness. He is called Mahiyasa. he is also great, the great soul. So unless one takes a shelter of the lotus seed or the dust of the lotus seed of a great personality who has no material affection, nobody can understand what is God. Naishanamatistavadurukramandhin prishattamathopagamojada. As soon as one understands the spirit soul and the supreme soul, that can be understood only when one is taking shelter of a great personality freed from material contamination. This is the version of Srimad Bhagavatam. Otherwise, it is amazement. To understand about soul is amazement. To understand about God is amazement. So Vedic injunction is therefore that if you are at all serious to understand Tadvijnanam, that science, transcendental science, Tadvijnanam, Arthe, Sa Guru Meva Vigathe, the Veda says, then you must find out a bona fide spiritual master. Tadvijnanam, if you are serious in that.
O descendants of Bharata, he who dwells in the body is eternal and can never be slain. Therefore, you need not grieve for any creature.
Now, after putting forward all definitions and arguments from different angles of vision of different philosophers, theses, now Krishna concludes, my dear Arjuna, take it for certain that the soul within is eternal. So, because we are in Krishna consciousness, even if we do not understand what is the constitutional position of the soul, yet, because Krishna says, we should accept. This is called parampara, evam parampara pāpto. This I have been practicing. What does he say? Yes, the same verse, repeat.
O descendant of Bharata, he who dwells in the body.
He who dwells in the body. He began this instruction that deha dehi, the body and the proprietor of the body, or the resident of the body. Just like this hall, and we are a resident of this hall. We are different. We are not this hall. This lecture room, we are within this lecture room. But that does not mean that we are, or I am, or you are, this lecture. Similarly, the soul dwells in this body. The body is changed, but the soul is not changing. That was the beginning of conversation with Arjuna after he is surrendering unto Krishna as disciple. And again he concludes in that way. That is, take it from me, because you have accepted me as your spiritual master. This is the significance. If you accept somebody as spiritual master, you have to accept whatever he says. Otherwise there is no need. But if you cannot understand, you can inquire sincerely, that is not birth. But you have to accept. So, Krishna says, conclusion, what is that? that within this body, what is that? He who dwells within this body is eternal. Is that?
And
can never be slain. Because it is already described that soul cannot be burned, soul cannot be moistened, soul cannot be dried up, soul cannot be killed, soul cannot be cut into pieces. So many things. Just opposite of matter. Any material thing you take, even stone, iron, it can be burned, it can be cut into pieces, it can dry up, so many things, all applicable to the matter. But so far the spirit soul is concerned, it is just the opposite. Therefore, the conclusion is that na hannati hannamane sarire, even after this body is annihilated, the soul remains eternal. Just like if somebody comes and drives us out of this room, that does not mean that I am finished. I shall go and take shelter of another room. Similarly, when the body is killed or annihilated by nature or by force, the soul takes shelter of another body. That is the conclusion.
Considering your specific duty as a kshatriya, you should know that there is no better engagement for you than fighting on religious principles. And so there is no need for hesitation.
Fighting is a matter of duty. That is the kshatriya spirit. Fighting is not killing. Because people have no idea what is the soul. Therefore, they think that stopping war will help us in a peaceful condition of the society. But there are so many troubles. So long this body is there, the war is one of the items. Even war is stopped, there is no question that people will live forever. No. That is not the law of nature. Dukkhalayama sāsatam. This life, the problem is how to stop our contact with this material body. That is the problem. Not that these general people, they are thinking, if war, there is no war, then you shall be very happy. How you stop your war with Maya? Maya has declared war with you, or you have declared war with Maya. Devidhisa kanumai mama maya durastaya. The Maya, the material nature is enforcing. Why you are closing this door? Oh, because it is very cold outside. And we forcing immediately there will be cold, immediately there will be fog, immediately there will be excessive heat, immediately there may be earthquake. How you can stop it? So they simply think, just like innocent child, they are concerned with the immediate problem. But a sane man is concerned with the ultimate problem. So our ultimate problem is not this war. The ultimate problem is repetition of birth and death. That is ultimate problem. How to stop this? That is the problem. So, Krishna says that this is useless lamentation, that you do not wish to fight. It is a concluded fact that even your grandfather or relatives die, we will continue as so. You have to execute your duty. You cannot deviate from your duty.
Happy are the kshatriyas to whom such bright an opportunity come on joy, opening for them the doors of the heavenly planet.
Now, why the kshatriyas? It is said in the Shastra, if a kshatriya dies in the fight, then he is promoted to the heavenly kingdom, to take birth, because he is fighting for the right cause. So he is promoted. As in this world also, if you fight for some right cause, you are rewarded. Even after your death, your memory is commemorated. Just like in your country, so many brave soldiers, leaders, they have died. But you have honored them by keeping their statues because they fought and died for right cause, whatever we think, right or wrong. So the kshatriyas, this is the Vedic injunction, who dies for the right cause, he is promoted to the heavenly planet. Now Krishna says, now it is a great opportunity for you. Suppose either you or your grandfather, the opposite party, die in this fight. So your promotion to heavenly planet is sure. And if you gain, then you get the kingdom. Both ways, it is profitable for you. Go on.
However, if you do not fight this religious war, then you will certainly incur sins for neglecting your duty and thus lose your reputation as a fighter.
On the other hand, if you don't fight, then you are known as a great warrior, a great soldier. If you go away, people will say against your reputation, oh, Arjun has become a coward. He has fled away from the fight. So it is better to die than to have bad reputation. That is another argument. Yes.
People will always speak of your infamy, and for one who has been dishonored, for one who has been honored, dishonor is worse than death.
Now, you are so much honored as Arjuna, the great fighter, Dhananjaya, and if you leave, you go away from this fighting and leave, and people will say, oh, Arjuna has become coward. He did not fight. Then what is the use of your living in such a way? Better die. Fight and die. That is good for you. Yes.
The great general, for highly esteemed your name and fame, to think that you have left the battlefield out of fear only, and that they will consider you a coward. 36.
A kshatriya, it is the custom of the kshatriya that if they are wounded on the back side, he is considered a coward. But if he is wounded on the chest, he is accepted as real kshatriya. That means he has fought face to face. That is the injunction of military art. In Vedic kingdom.
Your enemies will describe you in many unkind words and scorn your ability. What could be more painful for you? 57. O son of Kunti, either you will be killed on the battlefield and attain the heavenly planet, or you will conquer and enjoy the earthly kingdom. Therefore, get up and fight with determination. 58. Do thou fight for the sake of fighting, without considering happiness or distress, loss or gain.
Now this is duty. One has to execute duty without any consideration of loss and gain. That is duty, observing duty. Let's see. You are Kshatriya, there is necessity of this fighting, so you should not consider whether you are gaining or losing. It is your duty to fight. Go on.
And by so doing, you shall never incur sin.
Yes. If you execute your duty nicely, there is no question of sin. To execute duty is pious.
Yes. Lord Krishna now directly says that Arjuna should fight for the sake of fighting, because Krishna desires the battle. There is no consideration of happiness or distress, profit or gain.
This is Krishna concept. Krishna says, actually this happened, this is the Krishna consciousness. One should not think of personal loss or gain. Krishna desires it, so I have to do it. That's all. There is no personal consideration. That is real Krishna consciousness. Krishna, you are asking me to do this, I do not like to do this. You give me some other one. That is not Krishna consciousness. There is no, I mean, yes or no. As Krishna says, what Krishna says? Krishna says, the essence of Bhagavad Gita, that a person who preaches this sublime message of Bhagavad Gita, he is my dearmost friend in the human society. This is the open order of Krishna. Lord Chaitanya says, Amar Ajnay Guru Haiya Taro Sat Bodhis. Jare Dakho Tare Kaho Krishna Bodhis. Take my order. And you become a spiritual master. How? Simply speak Krishna consciousness. That. Simply speak on Krishna's message, Krishna Katha. There are two kinds of Krishna kathas. One is the Bhagavad Gita and the other is Srimad Bhagavatam. So, this is the propagation of Krishna consciousness. We have to abide by the superior order without consideration of our personal gain or loss. This is Krishna consciousness. There is no question of personal gain or loss.
Victory or defeat in the activities of Krishna consciousness, that everything should be performed for the sake of Krishna, is transcendental consciousness. So there is no reaction from material activity.
And if you do that, then there is no reaction. Jagya artha karmanatru lupanga. And if you do on your account, there is a reaction. Either you do good work or bad work, there will be reaction. If you do good work, you will get good results, and if you do bad work, you will get bad results. That's all right. But within this material world, suppose if you do pious activities, so what is the result of pious activities? According to Shastra, the effect of pious activity is that you can get birth in a very respectable aristocratic family. You can get a very nice wealthy position. You can become very beautiful, and you can become very learned. These are the four principles of pious activity according to Shastra. And if you do just the opposite, you take your birth in abominable family or in lower degraded animal species of life, no education, no beauty, no knowledge, there are so many things. So if you have to believe Shastra, these are the effects of bad and good work. Now, for a person who is in Krishna consciousness, he is not concerned with aristocratic family or abominable family. He wants to stop birth. So suppose one gets birth in aristocratic family or very nice family, what is the gain there? You have to live 10 months within the womb of your mother in suffocated condition. Either you take your birth in aristocratic family or in abominable family, either in human mother's womb or animal mother's womb, that does not make any difference. So, Krishna conscious person is neither interested in pious activities or impious activities. But one who is in Krishna consciousness, all activities are pious, transcendental, automatically. He hasn't got to try separately the Shasti Bhakti Bhagavata Kinchana, anyone. Take for example, non-violence. Non-violence is good quality. Now here you see Krishna and Arjuna. Arjuna is a devotee of Krishna. Automatically he is trying to be non-violent. Why should I fight? This is Krishna consciousness. Because he is devotee of Krishna, non-violence is already his quality. People are starting vegetarian society to become vegetarian, uplifted society. But the persons who are in Krishna consciousness, they are already vegetarian. That means the people in the ordinary status, they are trying to acquire some good qualities. But in Krishna conscious person, you will find all the good qualities automatically. That is the difference. So Krishna conscious person is not interested that this is a good work or this is bad work. He is interested with Krishna because his activities in Krishna consciousness is all transcendental. Better than gold, Suddha Sattva, pure goodness. In the material world, the goodness, the quality of goodness is sometimes tinged with passion and ignorance. But in pure goodness, which is Krishna consciousness, there is no tinge of passion or ignorance. And automatically, everything goes. Yes.
He wants to ask for his sense gratification. He recruits his own passion, levels to the reaction.
Yes.
So he
That is explained, yes.
Anyone who has completely surrendered himself to the activities of Krishna consciousness is no longer applied to anyone, nor is he attended to anyone, as we are in the ordinary course of activity. He says, quote, anyone who has completely surrendered unto Krishna, Mukunda, giving up all the duties, is no longer a debtor, nor is he obliged to anyone, not the demigods, nor the sages, nor the people in general, nor kinsmen, nor humanity, nor forefathers. That is the indirect hint given by Krishna to Arjuna in his birth, and the matter will be more clearly explained in the following verses.
That's all. Come. There is a verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Devarsi bhutaptuninang pitrinang. Devarsi bhutaptuninang pitrinang. Nayang rini na kinkara rajan. Sarvatmanaja saranam sarannam gato mukundam parihattukattum. The meaning of this verse is that anyone who is born in the human society, civilized society, he is indebted immediately, just a child is born in a family. So according to Vedic injunction, he immediately becomes indebted to so many items. What is that? He becomes indebted immediately to the different demigods. Sun, moon, Indra, Chandra, so many. Because we are receiving light from the sun, from the moon, so we are indebted. People do not care for it because they have no knowledge. Therefore, in the Vedas, a sacrifice is recommended to perform respective duty to become discharged from the indebtedness. So you are indebted to the demigod, indebted to the sages, just like Vyasadeva. Vyasadeva, he has given us so many Vedic literature. So we are taking advantage. So Deva, Rishi, Bhuta, ordinary living entities, even cats and dogs. But instead of being indebted, we do something else. Just like you are drinking milk. So we are indebted to the cows. So instead of repaying the indebtedness, we are killing them. So in this way, we are complicated in so many ways. Devasi bhutas ninang pitrinang. Pitrinang means in the family in which you are born. You are indebted because you are inheriting property, you are inheriting the mother's affection, father's affection. So are you indebted? People should consider. That is civilization. So, anyone who has taken shelter of Mukunda, Mukunda is Krishna, he has no more any indebtedness. He becomes free. All indebtedness, a charge is taken by Krishna and he will square up the account. There is no doubt about it. He says that. Aṅtāṅ sarvapāpibha mokkhoisya. Yes. So any question? Yes.
I
understand that
there
is a sense
where red or blue in the temple.
What is that?
She said this is a sense of red or blue in the temple.
Blue?
Red or blue, which one is white?
Why
is there a sense of red or blue clothing in the Christian temple?
Oh. Because it is red and blue. Is that all right? You see, you have to accept the Vedic injunction as it is. There is some meaning. Which may not be explained immediately, but because it is so enjoined, we have to accept it. Just like the corn cell is the bone of an animal. Now, in the Vedas it is said that if you touch the bone of an animal or human being, you have to take bath immediately to purify yourself. Now this corn cell is also bone of an animal. And it is kept in the deity's room. Now if you say, the bone of an animal is impure, how it is that? It is kept in the deity's room. So actually it is being done. Why it is being done? Because it is injunction of the Vedas. Similarly, all such injunctions we have to accept, but there is meaning. There is meaning, and that may not be understood immediately, that doesn't matter. So, if instead of red garment, if you take this saffron, what is harm to you? So you should accept the injunction.
lives, and yet not so clear to understand why it is so important to Arjuna, or to the Krishna should say to Arjuna that it is so important to recognition. Because in Arjuna's own heart, he knows that he is being kind, or that he is in confusion because he is kindness. Does this make a difference, the opinion that one's fellow Kshatriya will have?
Arjuna was reputed as a great warrior. So he should remain a great warrior. A warrior's business is not to stop fighting on the plea of becoming kind. If you have gone to the war field and if you practice non-violence there, it is useless. Why should you go? There is a Bengali proverb that naaste bose ghumtatam, that in India the girls, they cover their head. That is the system of married girls shyness. So it is said that one girl is on the stage for dancing. Now, while she is to dance, she is covering the head. What is the use of covering the head? You have come to dance, you dance. Similarly, in the war field, you have gone there to fight. What is the question of becoming non-violent? Things should be done according to the time and atmosphere. In the war field, there is no question of non-violence. That is, the war is arranged for committing violence. Where is the question of preaching their non-violence? Renounce what? Who said? So that is his cowardice. That is being condemned by Krishna. That it is not your business to give up fighting and go away from the war field and go to the forest for meditation. It is not your business.
How does that work?
And, it is sometimes knife is pierced in your body by a surgeon, and in another occasion another man pierces a knife to stab you. Do you think both knife piercing is the same? They're similar.
So,
what? Huh? Now, first of all, try to understand this. That piercing the knife in the body is not always bad. Similarly, war or fighting is not always bad, provided it is done for right cause. That should be understood. So when the director is Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead Himself is directing. So there is no cause of stopping. He has His plan, He knows. We cannot judge. So He is the Supreme. So that worry is necessary because it is desired by the Supreme Lord. To maintain the laws of the world, as to maintain the laws and order of a state, there is violence department, the police department, the military department. Why? The government can stop it. This is unnecessary expenditure. No. There is necessity for maintenance of the state. Similarly, war is sometimes necessary for maintenance of the order of the world. But people have misused, that is a different thing. But here, in this battlefield of Kurukshetra, there is no question of misuse, because it is under the direction of the Supreme Personality of God. There is no such question of misusing. War is necessary, but that does not mean it should be misused. There are so many instances, just like sex life is necessary for generating, for progeny, but that is being misused for sex gratification. That is another thing. In Bhagavad Gita, it is said the sex life in religious principle. The religious principle means, according to Vedic injunction, putra te kriyate bhargya, putra pinna prayajanam. There is necessity of a bona fide son in the family. And to beget a bona fide son, there is necessity of accepting wife. So, acceptance of such wife and sex life in that connection is not abominable. But to keep some friend and enjoy sex life for sense gratification, that is abominable. But the function is the same. Somebody may say, why, this is also sex life, that is also sex life. But there is much difference. Similarly, apparently, a thing may appear to be the same, but it has got great significance. That is to be judged by higher authorities. That higher authority is, supreme authority is there, Krishna Himself. Illusion. And enviousness. Kaam, krodh, lust. Lust, anger, lust is also. Kaam, krodh, lobh, moho, matsarya, moda. Moda means illusion. Matsarya. First thing is kaam, lust. Second, krodh, anger. Third, greediness. Kaam, krodh, lobh, moho, illusion. Moda, madness. Kaam, krodh, lobh, moho, moda, matsarya, enviousness. These are six. So,
Anything more?
What is necessary?
Hmm?
What is necessary?
That's why they don't you see all these people of the world, they're mad. What they're doing? The whole day the cars going this side, that side. What is the aim of life? They're mad. Simply wasting petroleum, that's all. What they're doing? Suppose a cat and dog goes this side and that side, go, 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 and he goes some motor car. What is the difference? There is no difference. Because the aim of the life is the same. Therefore they are mad. That is explained. Nunam pramatta kurute vikarma jadindriya pritaye aprinoti. Nunam pramatta. Pramatta means mad. Prakishta rupena matta. Sufficiently mad. And why? Kurute vikarma. They're acting which they should not act. They're acting in a way in which they should not have done. So what is the aim of their acting? Indriya pritaye, simply for sense gratification. So Rishabhdev says, na sadhu manne, this is not good. Na sadhu manne. Jato atmanoyam asannapi klesa de asadeha. These madmen do not know that this is the cause of getting this miserable material body. The suffering of humanity is due to this material body. And the cause is vikarma, acting for sense gratification. So this life is meant for acting for liberation, but they are acting for sense gratification, therefore they are mad. They do not know the aim of life. Life after life they are working, the cat's life, the dog's life, the horse's life, the man's life, or even demigod's life. Simply for sense gratification. And so long he will continue these activities of sense gratification, he will have to accept some sort of material body in the 8,400,000 subspecies, either as demigod or as dog. So this is going on. The Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Eirupe Brahmanda Samite Kono Bhagavan Ji. They are encircling or circumambulating in this cycle of birth and death. Out of many, many millions of such persons, if one is fortunate, he comes in contact with Krishna's representative, and by which he becomes Krishna conscious and his life becomes sublime. So this is madness, simply for sense gratification. They have no other business. This is madness. What do you think? This is not madness? Yes. And there is no difficulty to find out a madman. Any man you find out is a madman. And that is medical version also. That is medical version. In India there was a case, a man was murdered and the criminal lawyer pleaded that he was in madness. So this is the expert, the medical practitioner was invited. And he was asked to examine whether this man is in madness. So he said that so far my experience was, I have studied every man is a madman, more or less. Every man in the material concept of life is a madman. Because he does not know his identification. Therefore he is a madman. Pishachi paile jana madichchana jaya. Just like a ghostly haunted man. His father is standing before him and he is calling the father by ill name because he is ghostly haunted. Similarly, a living entity who is entrapped by this material energy, illusion, he is a madman. And the whole treatment is to get out of this disease of madness, misidentification, misconception of life. So it is not difficult to find out a madman. Any man is a madman. Yes.
Prabhupada, what is the position of Lord Shiva?
Lord Shiva is a demigod, but he is higher than all other demigods. He is higher than Lord Brahma, but he is not the Supreme Lord. Just like there are different gradations, that is not difficult to understand. In society also, there are different gradations. Similarly, the living entities, there are different gradations. So, all the living entities, they are, some of them are situated in higher planets, some of them are situated in lower planets, some of them are situated in high-grade life, low-grade life. So, the demigods are also, they are living entities, but they are enjoying better standard of life due to their acts of piety. But Lord Shiva is not amongst living entities. He is above the living entities. But he is counted as one of the demigods. But his position is better than Lord Brahma. Brahma is to be the highest living entity within the universe, and Lord Shiva's position is higher than Lord Brahma. Yes, Parvati. Yes. Sati. Everyone has got wife. Yes. Shakti. Yes. Everyone is devotee. Only the madman, they are not devotee. Any sane man is devotee. Sanity means become devotee. That is sanity. And one who is not devotee is insane. Insanity. So how you can express a Lord devotee is not devotee? Lord Shiva is not devotee. He is not insane. We are the material, the ordinary living entities in the lower grades of life, they are all insane. What is that? Yes. Yes. Durga is the material energy. So Lord Shiva is directly connected with the material energy. Therefore, he is less than Lord Vishnu. Vishnu is not directly related with the material energy. The example is given in the Brahma Sanghita. Just like meal, as soon as in connect touch with something sour, it becomes jugar. So jugad is milk, but it is not milk also. Your child requires milk, you cannot give jugad. Nobody can argue, jugad is milk preparation, why not give? No, it will be not beneficial for him. So similarly, if you want relief from this material world, you have to take to Vishnu, no other demigod.